Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Berean Baptist Church. And sometimes what you'll have happen is you'll have a storm come through and it kind of breaks the back of summer. And then all of a sudden it kind of cools down. It's kind of wonderful. This is about as wonderful as it gets. Just a beautiful, beautiful day out there. And so it was such a beautiful day. I'm so glad you came inside. Okay, because we're going to have a beautiful day here. God's going to speak to us today, and it's going to be wonderful. And you're going to make it wonderful because you're going to sing right now. And so go ahead and find your songbooks. Brother Carl Niederwerfer is going to lead us in a song. He'll tell you what to do here.
Okay, it's number 431. I'll get there. Anyways, very joyful song. Let's all stand, please.
Maybe going, Pastor, what is in the world does that mean? Saved from what? If you don't know, then you are exactly in the right place today. Because there we have a Savior. That's who we worship, Jesus Christ. He's called a Savior. Well, a Savior saves from something. It's important to know what to be saved from. We're going to have a word of prayer. We're going to ask God's blessing on the service. And then hang on to those songbooks, because we're going to sing again in just a moment. Let's pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this wonderful day that you have made. Because you have made it, we will rejoice in it. We thank you for the beautiful weather. We thank you for wonderful friends. And we also thank you for answers from your word. We are very well aware we live in an amazingly confusing time. But we know you're not confused and you're not off your throne. And you can help us today. So we look to you for help, and we look to you for the answers. Draw us to yourself, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And don't be seated just yet. Brother Carl will tell you what's next here.
Okay, number 16. It is no secret. We'll greet each other after the first verse.
The sunshine, the sun, the wind, 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 the sun,
wonderful singing. Okay, I know I have only one. I have one bulletin of the month left because we're going to a new bulletin next week. So I've got one. First come, first serve. Raise your hand. You get it. Got one bulletin left for the month. Looking. Brother Andrew says he'll give up his if it'll make anybody feel better. It'll take away your guilt for taking the last one. Anybody want that? Just looking. Got one bulletin to give. Going once, going twice. And then they're just afraid to commit. Afraid to commit to the bulletin. So glad to have each and every one. Yes, I know you want. I'll tell you what. We will get that to you at the end of service. They already put it back, but we'll get it to you. So anyway, I have to watch. I mean, one of these young men here, they got to watch. And they're timing me right now. They're sure to tell me that during greeting time. I didn't have the heart to tell them. Other people are timing me too all the time. And so glad to have you here. To our visitors, we're so glad to have you here right now. Zinni, glad to meet you today. We have a gift bag for you, Paul. If you could give that to Zinni right now. Co-worker of Ashley. You know what? That's good. You know what? It means that Ashley made a good impression. That magnet goes to someone else. There's already a magnet in the bag, Paul. Thanks for trying. Okay, thanks for giving her the 2-for-1. But anyway, what that means, Ashley, you made a good impression, because trust me, if she didn't like you as a coworker, no way would she be here today. So that is good. Lisa, glad to have you here. You already got your gift bag in the morning, but glad to have you here. Facebook friends with Abigail. Now Abigail knows, well, I thought I had Facebook friends, but now I realize I have a real friend. So that's a good to have too. And right here, Paisley, good to have you here. I have a magnet to give you, Paul. Right up here, Paisley, raise your hand. Glad you came on the shuttle today. Abigail, thanks for helping bring her today. I'm glad you did that. But I want to give you a little magnet. I think, Abigail, you have one of those already, but she had not got one yet. So glad to have you folks here. Let me give you some of the announcements that are taking place today. Just want to make mention of a few things. Tonight we have Sunday night service, but not here on site. Sunday night service is going to be at whose place? Ladies, raise your hands right there. They're pointing. Danelle, you live there too. She's pointing like she doesn't live there. Okay, Sharon, right here. Sharon and Danelle Sackerson. This is Sackerson Ranch. I believe it's 71800 Webb Road. Did I say that right? Wow, I got it memorized. That's Pilot Rock, 71800 Webb Road. You can put it in Google and get there, or put it in Bing and get lost. One of the two. One of the map sites, it doesn't work well, but if you get started in the right direction, you find a Webb Road. We're going to be meeting there at 6. We're not having Berean brunch after morning service because we're having a meal on site at the Sackersons after the evening service. And so that'll be at 6 o'clock, and so I want you to know that that's coming. Really hope you can come. Do yourself a favor. We may have a few chairs around, but bring a camp chair or two with you. Bring enough for the crew that you're taking. Listen, this is a church service, not a picnic. So no, it's not, let's lay down picnic blankets and roll around on the ground. No, it's not that type of thing. It is a church service, and so bring your chairs, and we do the church in a wildwood. We set up a pulpit. I mean, it eventually gets posted on Facebook, and it literally looks like we're just having a church service right in the middle of the woods. And so anyway, it's a wonderful thing. Bring your favorite dish, bring a salad, bring a dessert, bring another side dish, bring a dessert. You get the picture. Dessert's good. And anyway, we'll have a wonderful time up there. You may want to bring a jacket, and I know that's hard to believe, but the weather's cooled down a little bit. And so if it gets breezy there, you may actually get a little chilly. And so you'll want to bring that. But pray for the breeze, because if you have the breeze, you don't have the bugs. So that's always good too. And so anyway, letting you know that those things are happening. For those of you getting ready, let me make mention of this. For those of you getting ready for the Family Fun Fair, that is taking place September 22nd. We are going to have some planning meetings. Thank you to the men who really upgraded our path. It was looking pretty bad, but we got it upgraded and we got gravel. And some of you say, well, Pastor, there's still a big pile of gravel there. What's going to happen with that? Don't worry, I have plans. You know, somebody once said this, God loves you and everyone else has a wonderful plan for your life. And so anyway, we got plans for that, but we will have a meeting next Sunday night at 5 p.m. We'll have another planning meeting for that family funfair that is coming in September. So anyway, want to let you know that's happening. This is the last Sunday that we're receiving offerings for the generator in Togo, Africa. They have had terrible trouble with the electric grid there. And so he needs to buy a generator because they'll start their night service. It's near the equator, so the sun sets at 6, and by 6:15 it's pitch black, and I mean it goes out. And so we're raising funds for electric generator, and so this will be the last Sunday we receive funds. What do I put on my tithe envelope? You put generator to go, and that will get it to exactly where it needs to go. So I wanted to let you know that those things are happening. By the way, Roundup's already almost around the corner. Can you believe this? We're almost there, which means we'll have our annual parade outreach on the 7th. We're going to have Roundup Sunday with Brother Gene Harmon. Brother Gene Harmon and Nellie, they're coming. He's going to be our guest speaker. We are going to have, because we need to do this in honor of the Roundup, we are having a men's chili cook-off at 5 o'clock Sunday on September 15th, okay? And so, listen, make sure it's real chili. Some of you like putting things in there. Somebody likes putting rattlesnake in their chili. If you're putting an alternate mystery meat in the chili, please label that. We want to know that. We want to know if it's squirrel or possum or whatever you're putting in there. We want to know that. And so let us know that that is taking place as well, okay? Enough of that. Now that I whetted your palate and everybody's going, wow, now I'm hungry. And we're going to continue on with the service here. We're going to have the men come forward where we can receive our Sunday morning offering. This is an opportunity to give to our tithes and offering. It's an opportunity to give to missions. For those of you who've been praying for Graceway Baptist Church, the upgraded offer, there still is no word. And so we'll continue to pray for them. Do me a favor, also pray for Pastor William Durking. He is in Kona, Hawaii, trying to decide whether or not he is going to be able to have his church service in the pavilion, which means that there's three walls that are not there in the middle of a hurricane. And so right now, hurricane's bearing down on the Big Island, so I just pray for Pastor Durking there as they go through that. Going to ask God's blessing on the offering. Sean, I'm going to ask if you would bless the offering, please, this morning.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We get to come into your house and just hear your word, have fellowship. We pray, Lord, for this offering, that you would use this to help spread your word, spread the gospel, help those in need. And we pray for this pastor,
thank you.
Okay, we're going to turn to the most famous hymn in the world. Now, what is that? Amazing Grace. What number is it? Anyone know? Number three. Number three. Let's all stand, please. Amen.
That's it. I used to have a deacon who hung out right about where Brother Glenn was. First church I was in Stevensville, Montana. And the choir would sing and we'd get done. He'd yell out, "You're getting better." That's what he would do. And so we're going to turn in the Word of God to the book of 2 Thessalonians this morning. Book of 2 Thessalonians. Both the book of 1 and 2 Thessalonians dealt with the hope of the gospel in a church that was undergoing persecution. The Apostle Paul was only in Thessalonica for 3 weeks before he got chased out of town, and yet God established a church there. But there was all sorts of doctrinal issues that happened. One of the problems was is they kept saying there was a rumor that said, well, the rapture already occurred and you've all been left behind. Now, that was a little disconcerting. But Paul answered that question, and in this chapter we're in, chapter 2, the Apostle Paul deals with that a little bit, saying you're going to have to look for a few things first before you can emphatically say that. And to those of you that are born again here today, your sins are forgiven, you're on your way to heaven, and sometimes you wonder about the mess we're in, I'm here to tell you, Jesus makes a differentiation, if you ever look at Matthew 24, and Matthew 25, between tribulation and the great tribulation. And you know, we are certainly in tribulation right now, okay? You know, if you had a bad day yesterday, you probably weren't alone. You know, if you have a bad day tomorrow, you won't be alone either. We're kind of in a time of tribulation. In fact, Jesus promised it. He said, in this world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. And so we have hope even in tribulation. What we have here in 2 Thessalonians, we have a line drawn between tribulation and great tribulation. And you're saying, great, Pastor, I can't wait. Is that what the message is about? No, but I'll tell it to you anyway. And so 2 Thessalonians, looking at chapter 2, we're looking at verse 7. Look along in the Word of God with me. 2 Thessalonians, again, chapter 2, starting in verse 7. And it says this, "For the mystery of iniquity doth already work." Okay? So for those of you going, hey, it's a mess here, this is, yeah, the mess is here. It says the mystery of iniquity, the time of evil is already at work. But then it says this, "Only he who now letteth will let." And sometimes we get mixed up in the old English. The word "let" here means hinder. He that is hindering, he that is restraining, will continue to hinder and restrain until he be taken out of the way. And the one who hinders and restrains iniquity on planet Earth is the Holy Spirit of God. Okay? The Holy Spirit of God indwells every born-again believer, okay? Here's the good news. If he goes, you go, okay? We call that the rapture. You know, in the book of John, in the book of Revelation chapter 4, you know, the Lord said, the angel of the Lord said to John, come up. And when he came up, all of a sudden he's looking in heaven. That's going to be you. God's going to say, come up. And you know what? It's kind of like eminent domain. You know, if the government comes to take your house, they say, we're buying your house. No, you cannot say no. You're moving. If God says, come up, guess what? You're moving. So that is happening. But it continues on here, and it says this. And then it says, then shall that wicked be revealed. The wicked is known as the Antichrist. The Antichrist has not been revealed. You go, well, Pastor, do you think the Antichrist is hanging around? Go, I have a list. You know, could be this one, could be this one, could be this one, could be this one. There's plenty who want to fill that bill, I'll tell you that. But it says, then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. That's the end of the great tribulation. Bad idea to be the Antichrist at the end of the tribulation. Even him whose coming is after the working of Satan with all power and signs and lying wonders and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish. Why did they perish? Here's the answer. Because they received not, look how it's worded, they received not the love of the truth. Did you catch that? It's not just that they didn't receive the truth. They did not receive the love of the truth. What was the love of the truth? It was, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. It wasn't just that Jesus gave us a savior. Jesus gave us a loving savior, but they rejected the love of the truth. They rejected God's love in their lives that they might be saved. Now this brings us to verse 11, and we're going to camp out on this in a moment here. And for this cause, God shall send them strong delusion. We have a word to define there. We will in a moment. That they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believed not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. And the title of the message is going to be a dialogue with the delusional, and we'll get to that in a moment. But let's have a word of prayer at this point. Dear Heavenly Father, we come and as we look carefully at your word, and we realize that you're God of all, and when you gave us your word, you gave it to us word for word. You did not give us the approximation. You gave us the specifics so we could understand the specifics of what you were going to do and how we can be saved. So I pray now that you would use every part of your word in our hearts today and help us in a special way. And those that do not know you, that they will come to you today. And those that do know you but have gone off track will come back to you, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Now, it is important to know definitions. If you do not know words, you're in trouble when you communicate. Men in the room, there's a struggle here. Because you know words, but you know less of them. Your wives know words and they know definitions. One of the difficulties is sometimes they know three definitions for your word. So this could be crazy here, but we need to look at definitions of words here to understand what is going on. I want to define two words for you right now this morning, because without it, we can't move ahead in this message. One word is illusion, okay? An illusion, let me give you a quick, short definition of illusion. It's the deception of perception. The deception of perception, and that is by another person, okay? Anybody ever seen magicians here? By the way, I know how to do a magic show. You want to see a magic show? Here we go. See? Magic show just happened, okay? Okay, or watch this. Magic show. There we go. So, we have, but it's the illusion is the deception of perception where somebody tries to deceive you either by what they say or by what they show, and what you see and hear has deceived you. That's illusion. By the way, this is an election year. We got a lot of that going on right now. Okay? The second one is delusion, and delusion is the one in Scripture here. Now, this is why this needs to be defined. Illusion is the deception of perception by another, but delusion is the deception of self by self. That is what delusion is. It's where literally a person goes and they look in the mirror and they self-deceive, and it doesn't matter. There can be incontrovertible facts, but they ignore the facts and they say, whatever I perceive is the truth, that is the truth, regardless of inescapable evidence to the contrary. And you know what we have here, if we look here, it literally means an internal belief with no foundation of any kind regarding the belief. By the way, this is the crux of the passage that we're reading. We're reading that people who reject God, once they reject God, there is nowhere to go but down and way out. And I mean way out there. Okay? And even though we are not in the great tribulation, we are in tribulation, and the mystery of iniquity is already happening. There are already people that are actively rejecting God, and what they are coming up with is delusional. It's not even illusional, it is delusional. It's just like a person, and you know, they had their annual review, and somebody once sent me a text of different people that went through annual reviews, and the person who is the reviewer says, the individual has delusions of adequacy. That was their yearly review. And so we have this reality here. So we're now surrounded by people that are delusional. It's true. Do we give up? No, and the reason we don't give up is because God won't give up. And that's an important thing to understand, that we serve a God who will not give up on people. Good news, he will not give up on us. The Bible says in 2 Peter 3:9, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise. It means God isn't taking a coffee break. God is not going, well, things are really bad on planet Earth, but I've decided this is my vacation time. That is not God. God is not slack concerning his promise. That means Christ coming back and setting everything back the way it should be, as some men count slackness. Here it is instead. But is long-suffering to usward. It literally is the idea, God is long-suffering toward us. He is putting up with a lot, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And so for the person that you're fed up with and say, Lord, why don't you come back and crisp them right now? That is not how God feels. God said, I love them. I sent my son to die for them. I want them in heaven. I'm giving them more time. And so we shouldn't give up because God's not giving up. Plus, here is what it is. We do not know who we're really dealing with sometimes with these people around us. We do not know if we're dealing with the illusional confusional or if we're dealing with the dedicated delusional. We don't know if we're dealing with those who are outside deceived or those that are self-deceived. We don't know. So speak we must. So we're going to talk about having a dialogue with the delusional, because it is amazing how many people that Jesus has saved who were way out there before. Okay, so let me first of all give you some delusional examples. If you have your Bibles, and I know you do, go to the dead center of your Bible, turn to the Psalms. Turn to Psalm, and we're going to turn to Psalm 14:1. Psalm 14:1, because this actually is the definition of delusional. Psalm 14:1, and I'm going to give you three delusional examples that exist right now. I'm going to give you three. Pastor, how many are there? Oh, probably 10,000, but I only have time to give you three. Okay, you won't listen to me for 10,000, but you might listen to me for three of them, okay? Number one is this, Psalm 14:1, the fool hath said, this next part is important, in his heart there is no God. They are corrupt, they have done abominable works, there is none that doeth good. And so we have this important thing, it says, the fool has said, in his heart there is no God. It's not that he's weighed the evidence pro or con or contrary or not. He has looked in the mirror and he's made a decision within himself and has said, there is no God, and it doesn't matter what the evidence is. I'm saying this in my heart. I have convinced myself there is no God. And Pastor, are there people like that? There are. One time, this is kind of amusing. We had a Resurrection Sunday breakfast. This is 3 to 4 years ago. And we had a man, and he came in, and he sat through the service. I sat down across the table, and he doesn't believe there's a God. And we talked about it for a while, and I said, well, the message must have made you uncomfortable. He said, yeah, I didn't like it at all. But you had a breakfast, and I'm here for the food. Okay? He's delusional about God, but he's not delusional about food. And so, but the thing is, it's important to understand what it is literally. It's an internal, the person who convinces themselves that there is no God, it's an internal invention in their lives to absolve themselves of accountability. It's people who don't want to be answerable to anyone. And so they just say, there is no God, because guess what? If I don't have to worship God, then I can worship me. And I'm sorry, I've run into a lot of me worshipers in this place. So that's one delusional example, and the Bible defines it correctly as delusion because it's an internal process and an internal decision and a self-convincing. That's called delusion. That's delusion number one. Here comes delusion number two. And go ahead and turn to the book of Romans chapter 1. If you have a little time, go through there. It's easy. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Romans. No, actually it's Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans. So, if you find any of those, you're on your way. Get to 1 Corinthians, go backwards, go to Romans, and go to Romans chapter 1. Let's get to the very, very beginning of the book. And I want you to understand that delusion is not a new thing. It's been around, it's just now it's around more. And so Romans chapter 1, looking at verse 21, it says, because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God,
neither were thankful, but here it comes, became vain in their imaginations, okay? Anybody know what imagination is? Anybody ever watch a little kid's program? They say, we're all going to use our imaginations, okay? Let's imagine that God is something else, okay? But imagination is something that takes place within an individual. And it says their foolish heart was darkened, professing themselves to be wise. They became fools and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man and to birds and to four-footed beasts and creeping things. And so another delusion is to change God into animals to worship or objects to worship. So that is another delusional item, and I'm going to read this other passage which quite clearly describes that, describes a man who takes half a tree and uses it to cook food and worships the other half of the tree. So you have in Isaiah chapter 44, and I'm just going to read this in verse 14. It says, he heweth him down cedars, he taketh the cypress and the oak, which he strengtheneth for himself among the trees of the forest. He planteth an ash, the rain doth nourish it. Then shall it be for a man to burn, for he will take thereof and warm himself. Yea, he kindleth it and baketh bread. Yea, he maketh a god and worshipeth it. He maketh it into a graven image and falleth down hereto. He burneth part thereof in the fire. With part thereof he eateth flesh, he roasteth roast, and is satisfied. Yea, he warmeth himself and say, aha, I am warm, I have seen the fire. And the residue thereof he maketh a god, even his graven image. He falleth down unto it, and worshipeth it, and prayeth unto it, and says, deliver me, for thou art my God. They have not known nor understood, delusional, for he hath shut their eyes that they cannot see, and their hearts that they cannot understand. And none consider in his heart, neither is there knowledge nor understanding to say, I've burned part of it in the fire, yea. I have baked bread upon the coals thereof. I've roasted flesh and eaten it. And shall I make the residue thereof an abomination? Shall I fall down to the stalk of a tree? They can't even notice it. It's delusion. It's self-deception. So self-deception number one, there is no God. Self-deception number two, to change God in animals and objects. Self-deception number three is to ignore irrefutable proof of a worldwide flood. To ignore the proof. Because remember, the definition of delusion is when a person rejects incontrovertible proof to decide to believe something else that cannot be proven. And you go, is that in Scripture? Well, we have both Scripture and we have observed fact right now. How many say the best science is science that's actually observed? Okay? I'm not setting you up here. The best science is actually observed science. This is the truth. You have science when you observe it. If you don't have observed science, all you have is a theory. You don't have proof. But observed science is provable science. And so looking here, 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 5 and 6, it says, for they willingly are ignorant of that by the word of God, the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of the water and in the water, whereby the world that was being overflowed with water perished. Okay. Now, there's this thing around called evolution. And people say, oh, it's proven. It's not proven. It doesn't even exist. In fact, all the evidence points against it. But there are people that are delusional. By the way, not all of them are delusional. Some of them actually know they're propagating the lie, which is why some people who believe it are delusional and others that believe it are the confusional illusional. So, let me give you some examples here. Evolution tries to tell you that fish fossils exist, except true observed science. No fish fossils exist in evolution. But they're there. That's my point. Because you see, when a fish dies, anybody ever had a little fishies in a fish tank? Okay? What does your little fishy do when it dies? When it meets its end? Okay, does it go down or does it go up? Okay, most say it goes up. It's now floating upside down, okay? Okay, it's doing the back float. It's doing the back float. It's not doing the back stroke because there's no strokes left. It's just doing the back float, okay? Okay, this is truly what happens in the ocean. Fishies die, they rise to the top, and things eat the fishies. Fish fossil, no fossil. Or, as you say, they sink to the bottom. And the moment they get to the bottom, things crawl out of the bottom of the ocean and they eat them. There's no evidence the fish exists in exactly 7 days. But we were told fish fossils were proof of evolution. No, they're actually proof against evolution, because you cannot have fish fossils unless you have a sudden worldwide catastrophic flood that buries everything in mud. But they don't want to believe that. Okay? Here's another interesting thing. Uniformitarianism, an evolutionist, says there's never been a worldwide flood. But there are seashells, observed science. There are seashells in the top of the Rocky Mountains. There are seashells on Mount Everest. How did they get there? Ask an evolutionist, how did the seashells get on Mount Everest? And their great intellectual answer will be, I don't know. Petrified trees, they're proof of evolution. Except the petrified trees that they're talking about, some of them are stabbing down through what they call millions of years of rock layers, and the tree isn't even upside up. It's upside down through millions of years of rock layers. And what do we do about Mount St. Helens, that pesky mountain that blew up in 1980, and so you have all these trees that are upside down in layers of mud that are already petrified. So here's what you have. 33% of scientists no longer believe evolution. I bet you didn't know that. Among the young scientists, you get 30 years old and younger, the number increases to 48%. What does that mean? Some people are getting tired of the confusion and some people are getting tired of the delusion. Understand, these are delusional examples. This is when people decide, I don't want to believe there is no God, which is delusional, but because of that, now I need to go down and I need to go way out and believe other weird stuff that I hear about. Now it's alien seeding, by the way, because there's getting to be too much evolution, evidence that shows evolution doesn't exist, so now the earth was seeded by aliens. Everybody moved to Arizona. True center of the world. Okay. Now those are delusional examples. What about illusional examples? Here's an illusional example. Please turn with me to Psalm 139. Psalm 139. Look with me in verse 14. And we have David, who was called the man after God's own heart, that seemed to know God better than anyone else in his day. And he said, I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. My substance was not hid from thee when I was made in secret and curiously wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. Thine eyes did see my substance, yet being unperfect. That is called the embryo. That is called, you know, the unborn child. And in thy book all my members were written. That means God has a plan for every child, born or preborn, which in continuance were fashioned when as yet there was none of them. What do we have here? Here's an illusion. Reproductive rights. That's an illusion. Go, well, how do you know it's an illusion? Okay? Well, let me ask you a question. Is reproductive rights, the right to reproduce. It's not. That's the thing. When they say reproductive rights, it's delusional, because they don't mean the right to reproduce, they mean the right to kill the unborn babies. It is as sensible as the Inflation Reduction Act. Okay? Does reproductive rights mean right to reproduce? No. Does the Inflation Reduction Act mean the reduction of inflation? No, it doesn't mean that either. So what's the problem here? It's misnamed. It's the right to kill a baby with a different DNA in the mother's body. The mother goes, I have a right to my body. I go, okay, what about the other body? It's not your body. That's somebody else's body. That's another human being. Are you telling me then you as a human being have rights, but the other human being doesn't? Are you saying, in the words of Ronald Reagan, I have observed that those who were for the killing of the unborn have been born? What an amazing thing. The people who are trumpeting to kill babies, they seem to be happy they exist. What an amazing thing. Do you know that Planned Parenthood was created, the founder created Planned Parenthood to destroy the African American people because she was a racist? Did you know that? Have you ever looked at the biography of the founder? It doesn't have anything to do with reproductive rights, okay? And here's the thing, and I have talked to ladies who have come through the other side of this, who have talked to me personally and said, I aborted my baby and I now understand it's murder. I've talked to them. No, they've come to God, they've asked God's forgiveness. Because here is the difficulty with it. The self-justification of today won't eliminate the guilt of tomorrow. And this is the way all sin is, by the way. People have a sin condition, they try to explain it away, keeps coming back. Explain it away, comes back. There's no way to get away from it except a Savior. It's the only way to get away from it. Here's another one. Gender dysphoria. Okay? What does the Bible say? The Bible says that in the image of God created he them, male and female. Created he him, male and female created he them. That's what the Bible says. Very, very interesting passage. Psalm, I'm just going to read this one verse here. Psalm 100, looking at verse 3. It says, know ye that the Lord, he is God. It's really where it starts with. It is he that made us and not we ourselves. So, It's he that made us. Here's the difficulty. Mutilation will not change the chromosomes. Mutilation will not change the different bone structure. Mutilation will not change the different brain construction. It won't change any of those things. And so there are now many detransitioners that talk about the terrible regret of a destroyed life. It's a reality. Some of it is delusional, some of it is illusional, deceived by others. And then let's go to 2 Timothy chapter 3, book of 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3, looking at verses 6 and 7. And this is talking about the delusional. They don't love God. They love themselves. God's not the source of truth. They themselves are the source of truth. That is the definition of delusion. But it says, for of this sort are they which creep into houses and lead captive silly women laden with sins. Who's creeping in the houses? That's the deadbeat boyfriend, by the way. Okay? It's the deadbeat boyfriend that shows up and just takes up residence on the couch and tells the girl, I love you, and I'm your boyfriend, and no, I'm not going anywhere. I'm sure glad you're drawing a paycheck, because I don't plan to. Says, For of this sort are they which creep into houses, lead captive silly women, laden with sins, led away with their diverse lusts, ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. And you know, what is God's desire for us? God's desire for us is to end the illusion. That's God's desire. The Bible says in Ephesians 4, looking at verse 14, it says that we henceforth, from this time forward, that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men. These are the illusionists, the sleight of men and cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive. It's God's desire to end the illusion. So we've talked about the delusional examples. We've talked about the illusional examples. And now it comes down to, how do we talk to these people? How do we talk to them? There is a dialogue you can have, so let's start with one thing here. Romans chapter 3. Look with me in the book of Romans chapter 3. Book of Romans chapter 3. Looking at verses 3 and 4, Romans chapter 3. Here's a good, interesting question. What if some did not believe? What if something was irrefutable and somebody didn't believe it? Somebody came up to you and said, I don't believe that these pews are real. I don't believe they're real. I don't believe they're made of wood. I think they're an optical illusion. I don't think that they're. It says, shall their unbelief make the faith of God without effect, okay? Their belief that the pews are not there, does it make them not there? And people all the time said, I don't believe in God. I don't believe God is there. Does that make God disappear? He doesn't disappear. He's still there. As it comes down to this, as we look here, God forbid, yea, let God be true, but every man a liar, as it is written, that thou mightest be justified in thy sayings and mightest overcome them when thou art judged. This is a hard thing for people to understand. If you believe something about God other than that what the Word of God says, or you believe something about God because you would like to think God is like that, understand God is not obligated to change for you. God is the God of the ages. He's the God of the Bible. He's not going to change his system. He's not going to change his rules. God is who he is. And so that's important to understand. God is, that's a dialogue to have when people say, well, I think God is this and this and this. And I once said that. I was going door to door. I had a lady say, well, I'd like to think God is this, this, and this. And I said, you know what? It's not for God to agree with us. It's for us to agree with him. Secondly is this, sin has always been the issue. That's what it really comes down to. The sin of man has always been the issue. And the struggle with the sin of man is it keeps us from heaven. The Bible says this, we're in Romans 3, looking at verse 9. What then are we better than they? No, in no wise, for we have before proved both Jews and Gentiles that they are all under sin. As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. There's not a superior race and there's not an inferior race. There's just the human race and the human race needs Jesus Christ. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And Jesus himself, when he talked about sin, he says, listen, sin has chains. Sin always promises freedom, but it always has chains. The Bible says in John 8:34, and this is our Savior speaking, Jesus answered them, verily, verily, I say unto you, whoever committeth sin is the servant of sin. It means they're chained, they're in bondage to sin. So, these are two out of the three dialogues. One is God's not obligated to change. For the person says, well, I want to believe this or I don't want to believe this. God's not obligated to change. Secondly, sin has always been the issue. It's always been the thing to be dealt with. And then the third thing is this. We don't need religion or self-help. We need a Savior. That's what we all need. The Bible starts when it talks about Jesus in Luke chapter 2. It says, "For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord." The Bible says in Luke 19:10, "For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost." The Bible also says, if you're still in Romans 3, looking at verse 24, "Being justified freely by His grace," that's God's grace, "through the redemption," that is the payment, the atonement that is in Christ Jesus, "whom God hath set forth to be a propitiation," that is the payment of the purchase price, "through faith in His blood, to declare His righteousness for the remissions of sin that are past, through the forbearance of God," that is the long-suffering of Almighty God. So we don't need religion or self-help, we need a Savior. And by the way, God cares about those that are deluded. Jesus died for those who either have succumbed to an illusion or have had their own delusion. Jesus still died for those people. And we still have the same message that we need to give them. The most amazing thing about Almighty God is how wonderfully patient He is. And as a young gospel preacher, I didn't realize that. As a young gospel preacher, I thought that God was toe-tapping and terribly impatient. I really did. And I discovered how long-suffering God is. I discovered how loving God is. And here's the wonderful thing. God gives time, but the time is limited. It says, "Look again, the Lord is slack concerning His promise, not slack concerning His promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." So God gives time, but He only gives so much time. Because what is very interesting is also in the Scripture, God makes this statement, and I'll just read it quickly in 2 Corinthians 6:2. "For He saith, I have heard thee in a time accepted, and in the day of salvation I have succored thee. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation." So even though God is long-suffering regarding when a person is saved, God also constantly says to those who have never received Christ, "Today's a good day." And then tomorrow God will say, "Today's a good day." And tomorrow God will say, "Today's a good day." Today's always a good day to be saved. And so here is what I say, because all of life is relationships. And all of you here, you have friends, you have loved ones, you have some that are delusional, and at that point you say to me, "Yeah, I've known that for a really, really long time." And then others, it's not delusional, they're illusional, they've been deceived. But they all deserve an opportunity again and again and again and again. Yes, God's waiting, but today is a good day to be saved. Let's have a word of prayer. Heads bowed and eyes closed, nobody looking around. We'll have a word of prayer. We'll extend an invitation. Only God knows the heart of every individual. Some of you here that I've spoken to this morning, you clearly know your eternal destiny. You clearly know that you're saved. You clearly know you're on your way to heaven. You already know that. And so what you've been dealing with is just the frustration of not being able to get through to a friend or a loved one. Sometimes you want to throw up your hands. Sometimes you want to give up. Don't give up. God hasn't given up. As long as they have life and breath, don't give up. But there may be others here and you say, "I'm not really sure where I am at. I really do not know that if I died today, if I'd go to heaven. I don't know." And some say, some would be more emphatic than that. They would say, "No, I know I'd go to hell."
Well, I'm here to tell you today's a good day. Today's a good day to get saved. God's waiting, but today's a good day. Dear Heavenly Father, please use your word in our hearts. Help us today. It's an all-important topic. The devil tries to deceive, and sometimes we try to deceive ourselves, but you have the truth. Help us come to your love. Help us come to the truth, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand together. There's a song. It's number 535. It's a simple chorus, but it's a very simple chorus that illustrates the simplicity of salvation. Salvation is not complicated. We're sinners. God is a Savior. Jesus died for our sins. Salvation is a gift. We can call out on God to receive it. Most people I've met want to go to heaven. I've met very few that wanted to go to hell. Most want to go to heaven. They've just never been told how to get there. And I'm here to tell you, and sometimes in the case of reception, the Bible says, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. That's what this song talks about. Let's sing this chorus together. If you have a need, come meet me today. Or take time at an old-fashioned altar, pray for a friend or loved one, whatever the need of your heart is, while we sing this chorus here. God loves you to love others.